وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل. أشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى we're going to carry on the seerah, the biography of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. We stopped at the age of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم لما تزوج خديجة. The umur, the age of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام لما تزوج خديجة, when he married خديجة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the age.
He's a bit ill. Somebody's in there.
Sorry.
No problem.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his age when he married Khadija was that he was 25 sana. He was 25 years of age, alayhi salatu wa sallam. And this was 2 months after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came back from Sham. So after 2 months when he came back from Sham, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he married Khadija. And our mother Khadija, her age at that time was, she was 40 years of age. ولذلك الإمام ابن أبي العز الحنفي in his kitab الأجوزة المئية في ذكر حال أشرف البرية, that's why he says وصار نحو الشام أشرف الورى في عام 25 ذكرى لأمنا خديجة متجرة وعاد فيه رابحا مستبشرا. So he came back from Sham, and when he came back from Sham, the Prophet ﷺ, he was 20 years of age. It was only 2 months after that returning when him and Khadija were married. And this shows you something very powerful, which is our Prophet ﷺ, the discussion of marrying Khadija only came when did it occur? After Sham. It only occurred after they came from Sham. And this shows you something very powerful, which is how quick things were done. The simplicity of it. And it was straight to the point. Marriage was not made into a excessive thing. The Prophet and Khadija wanted each other. The family, they facilitated it for them. So our Prophet was 25 years of age. And Khadija at that time, she was 40. And this, you have to realize the culture and the Arabs, the way they also perceive this issue. A 25-year-old marrying a 40-year-old woman. This is a powerful lesson that our Prophet ﷺ set for us. Which is the fact that the person chooses the person due to their value and their quality that they hold. Not the age of the particular person, but it's more of what? The value and the quality that this person possesses. Our mother Khadija, radiallahu ta'ala anha, she got married before the Prophet ﷺ to two men. She was married to the Prophet before him, two men married her. The first of those two men is Atiq ibn A'id. The first of them is Atiq ibn A'id, was the first man she married. And Atiq ibn A'id, who Khadija got married to, she had for him a boy whose name was Abdullah, and a girl, her name was Hindun. Her name was Hindun. Then Hindun got married to her own cousin, Safi ibn Umayyah from Bani Makhzum, Hindun. and she gave birth to a child called Muhammad. Her second husband that married Khadija was Abu Hala ibn Malik, who was from the people of Bani Tamim, and his name is Hind. She gave birth to him 3 children. She gave birth to a boy whose name was Hala, a boy whose name is also Hind, and also a girl whose name was Zainab. And this is very powerful because in our culture, in our way of looking at things today, if a woman is divorced twice, or the woman, she's been married previously twice, whatever the circumstances may be, that woman is looked down at. And she's seen as what? As that the problem is with her. And she's degraded. And that may not necessarily be the case. But Zalika, last night, I remember 6 years ago reading a book written by Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn Muhammad al-Mada'i rahimahullah. There's a book called Al-Murdifat min Quraysh. The kitab is called Murdifat min Quraysh. What this book is that women who married more than one man but were honorable women. Their marriage was to more than one man. They had married multiple times, but they were honorable women. So I tried to look for that book in my library to read it, because I read it many years ago, but I couldn't find it. It was very hard for me to find. And the kitab is not online. So I'm doubtful if the kitab is actually written by Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn Muhammad al-Mada'ini, or if it's written by Yazid ibn Abi Habib al-Azdi rahimahullah, who died in the year 125, or if it's Abu al-Hasan Ali ibn Muhammad al-Mada'ini, who died in the year 225 or 230 approximately. One of the two wrote the book. And this kitab shows you that these women were married multiple times, and the reason why their marriages never worked out for them, it was due to the value and the quality that they possessed. The man that they were getting married to was never reaching that level. So she, every time she got married, she realized she was greater in thinking, she was smarter, she was more mature, she was more dedicated than this particular man that she's married to. And so she would not go and stay in this relationship with him. She would leave him. And she would try to look for the next, and she would find that he's not her level or her caliber. So it's not always the case, that a man gets married multiple times that it's his fault. Or if a woman marries multiple times that it's what? It's her fault. It can always be a different situation. And you can all see through our mother Khadija, was there a woman as great as her, and as honorable as her, and as great value of her? There wasn't at that time. There wasn't. Ma'adalik, she was married twice before the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Another thing that is very looked down at in our community is that a man on his first attempt should never marry a widow who has no children. Very looked down at. And it's seen as something that is what? It's looked at something that is, that this person, what have you done to yourself? You're young, you're going to marry a widow, or you're going to marry a divorcee, okay, who's got kids. This is your first marriage. I don't think you should do that. Why? Because the culture doesn't accept that. So this is that which the Prophet ﷺ broke in the culture that he's from, the people he's from. He made and he set an example in this regard. And the Prophet married Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, and he stayed with her and remained with her. And never married a woman with her, by the way. Whilst the Prophet was married to Khadija, the duration he was married to Khadija, he never ever married another woman with her. He stayed with her alone. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Khadija, she gave birth to the Prophet and his children. She gave birth to the Prophet's children, alayhi salatu wa sallam. And Imam Ibn Abi Izz al-Hanafi, he summarized the children of Khadija and also the Prophet's children in general for a person to memorize it. He said, فَكَانُهُ فِي عَقْدُهُ عَلَيْهَا وَبَعْدَهُ إِفْضَاؤُهُ إِلَيْهَا وَوِلْتُهُ مِنْهَا خَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمُ فَالْأَوَّلُ الْقَاسِمُ حَازَ التَّكْرِيمُ وَزَيْنَبُ الرُّقَيَّةُ وَفَاطِمَةُ وَأُمُّكَ الْثُوبِ لَهُنَّ خَاتِمَةُ والطاهر الطيب عبد الله وقيل كل اسم لفرد زاهي والكل في حياته ذاق الحمام وبعده فاطمة بالاسفعام. This line of poetry our mother Khadija, she gave birth to وَوِلْدُهُ مِنْهَا her children, all of the children that the Prophet ﷺ had, all of them were from Khadija, ma khala Ibrahim, except who? Except Ibrahim. Ibrahim was not from Khadija. Who gave birth to Ibrahim? Ibrahim, he came from Maria al-Qibtiyya. Maria al-Qibtiyya, her name is, she gave birth to Ibrahim for the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. Maria al-Qibtiyya, her name is Maria bintu Shamrun. Her name is Maria bintu Shamrun. She was a gift that was given to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the leader from al-Iskandariya, al-Muqawqis. Al-Muqawqis, he gave Maria al-Qibtiyya the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a gift. When they migrated to what? When the Sahabas went there to send a message on his behalf. He sent to the Prophet Maria Qibtiyya. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had Maria Qibtiyya never as a wife. She was a what? She was milkul yameen. She was what your right hand possesses. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And Maria Qibtiyya, as you all know, the slaves, they don't wear the face veil. Like in Maria Qibtiyya, the Prophet ﷺ, he commanded her to cover up. She was commanded to what? She was commanded to cover up. And she became pregnant for him, alayhi salatu wasalam, and she gave birth to Ibrahim for him. She died, Maria Qibtiyya, she died fi khilafat Umar ibn al-Khattab. She died at the khilafah of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu's time. وَرَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهَا. May Allah be pleased with Maria Qibtiyya. And she died in Muharram when the year was 16 Hijriya. Khadija, she gave birth to some of the Prophet ﷺ قَبْلَ الْبِعْثَةِ, before he became a prophet. The only one, to be honest, that she only gave birth for him after he became a prophet was Abdullah. Abdullah was the only one that was born what? He was born after the Bi'athat al-Nabi, when the Prophet was sent as a messenger. The rest were born what? Before the Prophet was sent as a messenger. The first of the Prophet's children are who? The first of them is who? Al-Qasim. That's why he says, Ibn Abi al-Izz al-Hanafi says, فَالْأَوَّلُ الْقَاسِمُ حَازَ التَّكْرِيمُ. The first of them is Qasim. He surpassed them in honor. And he was the first child of the Prophet. And how did he surpass them in honor? In other words, he's the one that the Prophet took the kunya. The Prophet's kunya is what? Abu Qasim. It was the first child that he had. Ibn Majah narrated in his Sunan, بِسَنَدٍ ضَعِيفٍ, a weak chain of narration. It's a very, very weak narration. That Husayn ibn Ali, he said, لَمَّا تُوفِيَ الْقَاسِمُ, when Qasim died, which is the son of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Khadija said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam that the milk that are in my breasts for Qasim, it hurts because of the fact that she needs to breastfeed. And he hasn't taken his milk because he died. In other words, she's trying to say he hasn't finished his duration. وَالْوَالِدَاتُ يُوضِعْنَ أَوْلَادَهُمْ حَوْلَيْنِ. If only he finished his 2 years, and then he died, she said. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in this weak hadith, إِنَّ إِتْمَامَ رَضَاعِهِ, the completing of his breastfeeding is in Jannah. That Ibrahim, Qasim, is going to be, his rida'ah has been completed for him in Jannah. Then Khadija said, لو أعلم ذلك يا رسول الله or Messenger of Allah, if only I knew that لهون علي أمره, his matter, if only I knew that, his matter would become so light on me, and I would be so hurt the way I feel under the pain I'm going through. Then the Prophet said to her, إن شئت, if you want, دعوت الله, I ask Allah and I call out to him, فأسمعك صوته, and I will make him, I will ask Allah to allow you to hear the noise of your son Ibrahim, Qasim, your son Qasim. In this hadith narrated Ibn Majah, and we said it is what? Da'if jidda, it's excessively weak. Many scholars, they bring it and it's weak, it's not authentic. It's hadith 1512, it's a weak hadith. Then, after Qasim, the Prophet's second child was Zainab. Zainab, she's the oldest daughter that the Prophet had. وَهِيَ أَكْبَرُ, she is the oldest, she's the eldest from what? بَنَائِهِ, from his daughters. Prophet's eldest daughter is who? His eldest daughter is who? Zainab is the eldest daughter for him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. And she also is وَأَوَّلُ مَنْ تَزَوَّجَ مِنْهُنَّ, and she's from the first that got married, of course. She's the oldest daughter, and she's the first that got married. And this is something we need to step over, which is this concept of if a younger sister marries whilst her older sister is there. In our culture, it's like, wait, let your older sister get married first, and then you can get married. Is that common in your culture as well? So the younger one, she's told to wait, even that she might be the one that wants to get married, and the older one's just relaxed. She doesn't want to get married yet. So she's told, the younger one is told, you would have to wait, let your sister get married, and then a year or two, you should get married. That's a cultural thing. It has no basis in the religion. One wants to get married, the other one, and the other one doesn't want to get married too. It's the person's choice. But the reason they say that is because people are going to shame your elder sister and say that she, no one wants her. And it's going to look bad on your elder sister's reputation. And don't make your sister look like that or seem to be like that. But Zainab, who's the Prophet's eldest daughter, she got married first. And she got married to Ibn Khalatiha. She got married to her cousin from her mom's side. Her maternal uncle's son. Her cousin from her mom's side. Are you able to open it together? Does that make sense? Her cousin from her mom's side. Whose name is Abu al-As ibn Rabi' al-Absi. Who is the mother of Abu al-As? Al-Rabi' al-Absi, who is his mother? His mother was Hala bint Khuwaylid. And Khadija's name is what? Khadija bint Khuwaylid. So it's his two sisters. She took Islam. Zainab, she became a believer and she believed in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَهَاجَرَتْ مَعَابِيهَا, she migrated with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she died when the year was what? 8 Hijriah, she died. If you want more details, you can find her story in Al-Isaba fi Tamyiz al-Sahaba. The second daughter, the third child and the second daughter is Ruqayya. Ruqayya binti Rasulillah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa daughter. Ruqayya was born when the Prophet was 33 years of age. The Prophet was how old? He was 33 years of age when she was born. And Uthman ibn Affan married her. Who married her? Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the one who got married to who? He got married to Ruqayya. And Ruqayya and Uthman, both of them migrated to Abyssinia together. They migrated together. وَهَاجَرَتْ مَعَهُ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِ الْحَبَشَةِ, she migrated with him, Uthman, to Abyssinia. The Prophet didn't go to Abyssinia, the Prophet was in Mecca. But Ruqayya and her husband, Uthman, they went to what? And this is something we need to ponder over, which is when the woman gets married and the man, they get married, that they should be separate now from the father and the mother. This connection under the same roof, living together. The Prophet ﷺ's own daughter, she left him. The minute she grew old, he raised her, he married her off, he passed her over to who? Uthman. And Uthman migrated with her. Where did he migrate her with? Another whole different man. Because she's under whose? Who is she under? She's under her husband, Uthman. He cares for her, he looks after her. It's a lesson that we take from. And it also takes the responsibility of the husband, also knowing that he needs to take his wife with him. That she's his responsibility now. And that he should try to play as much as he can to separate the husband, separate his wife, sorry, from the in-laws. And that visiting, like the Arabs, they say, Zid ghibban tazdid hubban. Zid ghibban, increase in absence, the hearts will increase in love towards one another. But if the people are always coming at each other, the morning they wake up, their wife wakes up, and their mother wakes up, and they see each other every day, this is not going to increase love. But if they are meeting each other, and they're coming to each other after a period of time, this increases love. They miss each other. Your children are missed. You're missed. And if every day you're in front, you'll see people, the love dies out. Or it's very little. So, Ru'aliz Ikhwani Bistira is a lesson for us. It's how we should live our lives, the way we should be. We take lessons from them. Any points that we see that we think lesson can be taken out of it, we take out of it, right? It's not to attack any culture, it's not to attack an individual. It's that lessons are in it for everybody. Ruqayya, she got married to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Mecca. And she travelled, as I said, وَهَاجَرَتْ مَعْهُ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِ الْحَبَشَةِ. She migrated to Abyssinia with him. And at that place, she gave birth, وَوَلَدَتْ لَهُ هُنَاكَ إِبْنًا. She gave birth to a boy. فَسَمَّاهُ he called it Abdullah. وَلِذَلِكَ Uthman, he used to be يُكَنَّ بِأَبِي عَبْدِ اللَّهِ. وَلِذَلِكَ Uthman's kunya is Abu عَبْدِ اللَّهِ. And Ruqayya, she died radiallahu ta'ala anha yawma waq'at Badr, when the battle of Badr, and that was the first battle that took place between the believers and this Quraysh, an actual battle that took place between them. She died and she was buried the day when Zayd ibn Harith radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came to give the news of the that the believers had won the battle of Badr. So the Prophet was, he was in what? Should he be pleased with the news of the news of the battle of Badr, or should he be saddened by the death of his what? His beloved daughter, Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha. ثم أم كلثوم. Then Khadija gave birth to what? Khadija gave birth to Umm Kulthum. This is the Prophet's what? This is the Prophet's third daughter. This is the Prophet. Can somebody hold him?
Yeah. Okay, sit over there.
Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Khadija gave birth to what? ثم أم كلثوم. She gave birth to أم كلثوم. أم كلثوم, she is older than Fatima. Even though there's a khilaf mentioned, she's older than Fatima. She is. Uthman actually got married to her after he married Ruqayya. When Ruqayya died, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he married her off to Ruqayya died, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his other daughter أم كلثوم to take the place of her sister and get married to who? Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he married two of the Prophet's daughters. No one got this privilege except Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And because of this, scholars, they said that he was given the title of what? Dhan Nurayn. He was given Dhan Nurayn. They say so. Fihi ma fihi. So Fatima and Umm Kulthum, all Rajah is that Umm Kulthum is older. She's the elder sister. She's elder, older than her in age. Umm Kulthum got married to who? Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And she gave birth to no child for Uthman, no children. And she died the year, ninth year of the Hijriyah. And the Prophet prayed on her. ولذلك the Prophet all of his children they died. Except who? Fatima. Fatima is the only one. ولذلك that's why Al-Imam Ibn Al-Izz he says والكل في حياته ذاق الحمى. All of his children they taste the bitterness of death. وَبَعْدَهُمْ فَاطِمَةٌ بِنِصْفِ عَامٍ. Fatima, she stayed after the Prophet what? Nisfi Aam. What's a Nisfi Aam? Half a year. Half a year as well. So 6 months after the Prophet she died. Fatima radiallahu ta'ala. Then the Prophet's youngest daughter is who? The youngest daughter was Fatima. Fatima, the Prophet told her she is what? Sayyida to Nisa al-Alameen. She's a Sayyida. She's the leader of the women of Jannah. She's the youngest daughter that the Prophet ﷺ had. She was born when the Prophet ﷺ was 41 years of age. And she died after the Prophet ﷺ, in 6 months after the Prophet died. And she was the first person to come after the Prophet when he died. Nobody from the family of the Prophet, the immediate family, or anybody else around, close family relatives, were as close as Fatima, as Ibn Hajar mentions. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu is the one who led the janazah for her, prayed on her. And her age at that time, she was 29, she was 29 years of age when she died. And some scholars, they said, She was 30 years of age when Fatima died. She died a very young age. Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the youngest child, the youngest was them, Abdullah. Abdullah is the youngest. And Abdullah is the one that is called At-Tayyib At-Tahir. It's called what? الطيب الطاهر ولذلك ابن العز says والطاهر الطيب عبد الله وقيل كل اسم لفرد زاهي. There's a khilaf. Some scholars they say طيب and طاهر are two other children of the Prophet. And some scholars they say لا طيب and طاهر is actually who? Abdullah himself. It's no other child. ولذلك ابن القيم says in his kitab زاد المعاد في هدي خير العباد he says in زاد المعاد he says that ثم ولد له عبد الله وهل ولد بعد النبوة أو قبلها فيه اختلاف. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم خديجة gave birth to عبد الله for him. Was he born after the prophecy or was he born before he became a prophet? فيه اختلاف. There's a dispute in this regard. وصححها بعضهم. Ibn Qayyim said some of the scholars they strengthened the opinion أنه ولد بعد النبوة. That he was born after the Prophet's prophecy. And then they differed. وَهَلْ هُوَ الطَّيِّبُ الطَّاهِرُ وَالطَّاهِرُ. Is he the one that's called الطَّيِّبُ الطَّاهِرُ أَمْ هُمَا غَيُّهُ. Or are they other two children of the Prophet? عَلَى قَوْلَيْنِ. There are two views in this regard. وَالصَّحِيحُ. Ibn Qayyim says the strongest opinion is أَنَّهُمَا لَقَبَانِ لَهُمْ. They are two nicknames that were given to Abdullah. The reason why he was given this is because he was the only one that was born after what? The prophecy, they said. Abdullah died as a very young child. He died very young. Qasim died when he was only 1 year of age. They say that he could only manage to walk, some scholars said. Some of them said, لا تمكنه من ركوب الدابة. He could only be managed if he was put on a riding beast, he could sit. That's it. Nothing else he could do. Abdullah was born, he died very young. All of the Prophet ﷺ's children, they all reached Islam. And they took Islam, those who could take Islam from amongst them. Those which are young are young. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, none of his children lived after him. They all died whilst he was alive. And the only child, as I said before, that lived after him was Fatima, and she فَقَدْ تُوفِيَتْ بَعْدَهُ بِسِتَّةِ أَشْهُرٍ. After 6 months now, she died. When Mushriki Quraysh saw the Prophet's situation, and they saw how he lost all of his children, especially his sons, the Arabs, they look at the boy, and that the only child that was left for him was Fatima. The Arabs, they started to what? تَعْيِيرُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ بِالْقِطَاعِ نَسَبِ الرَّسُولِ. They started to slander him, and they said, look at your lineage. Now it's disconnected. You no longer have your name carried on. This is it. Your lineage, your name is going to end there. No one's going to ever say, as they count and they mention their name, no one's ever going to say Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Muhammad. No one's going to say that. And your name stopped. That's it. They said that to the Prophet because of the fact that his sons were dead. And the person who uttered these words was Al-As ibn Wa'il. He said to the Prophet, لَقَدِ قَطَعَ وَلَدُ فَوَأَبْتَرُ. That the Prophet ﷺ, he's got no sons. So he's abtar. Abtar meaning a person who's not going to carry on. He's disconnected from the back. He just can't carry on anymore. And then Allah sent the verse down, إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ. The person who tries to ashamed the Prophet ﷺ by slandering him, calling him names, belittling him, that's the person who's abtar. He'll be disconnected, he won't. But there are hikam and wisdoms why Allah tabaraka ta'ala chose to put the Prophet ﷺ in that situation. Only he knows Allah tabaraka ta'ala. But what we can say is, wallahi, they lied to say that. Because half of the Mekatib said something very powerful. He said, Hasha wa kalla. Wallahi, no, that's not the situation. And impossible is this. بَلْ قَدْ أَبْقَى اللَّهُ ذِكْرَهُ عَلَى رُؤُسِ أَشْهَادٍ. Rather, the Prophet's name is the only name that remains over everybody's heads. Everybody is talking about him. He's been spoken about. He's been discussed. Politicians are talking about him. Governments are talking about him. Media wants to say things about him. On the streets, people are talking about him. In the masajid and the hilaf, the Prophet's been spoken about. Everybody, whether it be good or bad, he's been spoken about. He's not forgotten. And his name hasn't become disconnected. وَأَوْجَبَ شَرْعَهُ عَلَى لِقَابِ الْعِبَدِ. And Allah made the Prophet's legislation obligatory over everybody's neck. Mukatir says, مُسْتَمِرًا عَلَى دَوَامِ الْآبَادِ. Which will carry on forever until the day of judgment. إِلَى قِيَامِ الْحَشْرِ وَالْمِعَادِ. صَلَوَاتُ اللَّهِ وَسَلَامُ عَلَيْهِ دَائِمًا إِلَى يَوْمِ التَّنَادِ. ولذلك الإمام ولذلك the noble companion حسان بن ثابت in his lines of poetry in praising the Prophet, what did he say? وضم الإله اسم النبي إلى اسمه. Allah took the Prophet's name and he brought it and placed it right next to his name. إذا قال في الخمس المؤذن. When the caller of Adhan makes the Adhan 5 times a day, he says what? أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن Muhammad is mentioned next to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِذَا قَالَ فِي الْخَمْسِ الْمُؤَذِّينُ أَشْهَدُ وَشَقَّ لَهُمْ لِسْمِهِ لِيُجِلَّهُ. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he what? He picked from his name, so he can honor him. فَذُو الْعَرْشِ مَحْمُودُ وَهَذَا مُحَمَّدٌ. So Nabilah Muhammad's name is not what? It's not going to stop at a particular place or what? Time. He will be always remembered, alayhi salatu wasalam. But now I'm going to speak about bina'u al-ka'bati wa dar'i fitnatin azimatin. The rebuilding of the Kaaba. And the role that the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, took in this matter. The Kaaba, as you know, my beloved brothers and sisters, hiya awwal baytin buniya li'ibadati Allahi azza wa jalla. It's the first house that was built for Allah to be worshipped on. As Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا وَهُدَى لِلْعَالَمِينَ. إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ, the first house that was placed on this earth, وُضِعَ لِلنَّاسِ لَلَّذِي بِبَكَّةَ مُبَارَكًا, is the Kaaba. It's Mecca. Why was it placed? mubarakan, he was blessed. Wa hudan, and his guidance, lil alameen, for the world and the universe. And Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim both narrated on the authority of Abi Dharr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he said, Qultu ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, ayyu masjidin wudi'a fil ardi awwal. He said, I asked the Prophet, Abu Dharr asked the Prophet, he said, O Messenger of Allah, which masjid was the first one that was placed on this earth? The Prophet said, Al-Masjid al-Haram. Masjid al-Haram is the first masjid that was placed on this earth. The Kaaba, my beloved brothers and sisters, ta'arradat al-Kaaba to, the Kaaba endured so much. If it's the first house, it went through a lot. The Kaaba, it went through a lot. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he became a prophet, 5 years before he became a prophet, 5 years, a big wave of water came and it flooded the Kaaba. And what it did to the Kaaba was that it destroyed the construction of the Kaaba. It destroyed the construction of the Kaaba. And so Quraysh, between themselves, they saw the necessity for darrat Quraysh ila tajdeed bina'iha. They saw that it was necessary that they have to do something about rebuilding this Kaaba. And that the Kaaba is what? It's the place that all of the Arabs and the tribes honor the Quraysh for. And that they should protect wa hifadhan ala hurmatiha. They should protect its holiness. So Quraysh, what they did an agreement. Quraysh has many branches under Quraysh. They agreed, they made a decision that they're going to build the Kaaba. Rebuild the Kaaba. But when they look at the condition that they set for rebuilding the Kaaba, they said, we're going to rebuild the Kaaba, but there's a condition. What is it? أَلَّا يُدْخِلُ فِي بِنَاءِ الْكَعْبَةِ مِنْ كَسْبِهِ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. That the money that they're going to build the Kaaba with has to be money that's halal. Nothing haram. What's the haram that they are staying away from? فَلَا يُدْخِلُ فِيهَا. They're not going to build the Kaaba with money that is brought from مِنْ مَهْرِ بَغِيٍ. A prostitute's money. Her money is not taken from her and it's not used towards the Kaaba. وَلَا بَيْعِ رِبًا. And in riba, riba is also not going to be used in the construction of the Kaaba. وَلَا مَظْلَمَةَ أَحَدٍ مِنَ النَّاسِ. And money that was oppressively taken, unjustly taken from anybody will not be used towards the Kaaba. This is Quraysh. They were not what? They were not Muslims. Sorry? They were not Muslims. They were disbelievers. They were idol worshippers. But they knew the severity and the nobility of this house. That if they're building it, they have to make sure that the money that they're going to use towards it has to be money that is what? Tayyib. The Prophet, did he not say in the hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. Allah is tayyib. And he only accepts money that's tayyib, good money that's been brought forward. That's what Allah accepts. If you try to bring something that's not tayyib, something that's not good, Allah won't accept it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Quraysh, they brought all of the money that they could bring that was far from indecent money. All of the wealth they brought together. Then they said to themselves, we need to destroy the building, the Kaaba. And we have to bring the construction down. But when they thought that came to their mind, some of them were alive when Abraha got destroyed. They know what happened to Abraha when he came towards the Kaaba and he wanted to destroy the Kaaba. So they said to themselves, if any one of us goes forward to touch the Kaaba here now and tries to destroy it, فَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِنْ سِجِّيلٍ فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ. They're going to be destroyed here. So can we actually go and destroy the Kaaba? So they started to become very weary and concerned whether they should do that. And Walid ibn al-Mughira, who's the father of Khalid ibn al-Walid, put his hand up. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, al-Makhzumi, he put his hand up. He said, أَتُرِيدُونَ بِهَدْفِهَا الْإِصْلَاحِ. When you guys are destroying the Kaaba and you're bringing it to the ground, are you doing that to perfect it and to bring good for the Kaaba? Or are you doing this amid isa'ah, or you try to bring harm to the Kaaba? قالوا بل الإصلاح. They said that. We're doing this to bring about good for the Kaaba. And we're trying to do islah, trying to perfect the situation. He then said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُهْلِكُ الْمُصْلِحِينَ. The principle is, Allah does not destroy those who are good doers. Those who are trying to do good, and that are trying to perfect the situation of the Kaaba, Allah doesn't destroy them. Allah doesn't. وَأَخَذَ النِّعْمَلَ. So he took his what? Somebody garoon. That's what we call it, garoon. What do you say in English?
Axe.
He took his object and he destroyed, he hit the Kaaba with it. The rocks and that, bricks, he hit it with it. Garoon is all the Kaaba the Mughal. Yeah? Abdullah, do you know what garoon is? What kind of someone? What's in English? Axe, Mali. Okay. Axe is a bit different. He used it and he hit it on the Kaaba. When he did that, Quraysh did not move a finger. They watched him. They let him do what he wants to do. They said, we'll see you tomorrow morning. No one goes towards the Kaaba. No one touched the Kaaba. Let this man, let's see what happens to him tomorrow. Something could just happen tonight. So they slept the night. They didn't do anything to the Kaaba. They did not help him. In the morning when they woke up, they looked for him. He was fine, nothing happened to him, his situation was good. When they realized that his situation is good, they went and they started to destroy the Kaaba. And they were so scared when they were destroying the Kaaba, they kept saying, Allahumma inna la nuridu illa khair. Oh Allah, us doing this, we only intend. We only intend good for your Kaaba. We're not doing this for nothing else but to perfect the situation. So they kept destroying it. And every time they did that, they were saying that. They were destroying it. Until they came to the asas of Ibrahim, the point that Ibrahim built. This is the asas, the foundation Ibrahim placed. And when they came to the asas, they tried to destroy it, they tried to put sharp objects into there to touch it, but then they realized the Kaaba is moving and it's the whole structure is going to collapse fully. So they made their decision not to touch that part and to build on top of it. So they started to what? They started to leave that part of the Kaaba and they left the asas. Quraysh, all of them participated in this. Every tribe brought their money. Every tribe brought their efforts forward. They played their physical part. They played the financial side that was needed from them. Everybody did it. They took the Kaaba and they categorized the people into types. Each tribe, you have to remember, every tribe wants to play its role in the building of the Kaaba. This is a reputation, it's a name. History, they know history is going to write this. So the decision that was made was the side of the door is given to Abdul Manaf and Zuhra. They're going to be given to the side of the Kaaba. The side of the door of the Kaaba is theirs. Who is it? Abdul Manaf and Zuhra. As between ma bayn al-rukni, between the Rukn al-Yamani and the Hajar al-Aswad is given to Bani Makhzum and other Qabail, small tribes that fall under them. The back of the Kaaba, Zahru al-Kaaba, the back of the Kaaba, they say they're going to give that to Jumah and Sahm ibn Amr, ibn Hasis, ibn Ka'b ibn Lu'ay. And then the side of the Hijr, it's not built right now. People go in and sit, pray there, where you can't do the tawaf around. There's a part, it's called Hijr. You can't do tawaf in it. You go around it, but it's small. It's got a little wall there. That Hijr, the side of it was given to Abdiddar ibn Qusay, and also Asid ibn Uzza ibn Qusay, and also Adi ibn Ka'b ibn Lu'ay. They were all given portions of the Kaaba. This is what the part that they had to bring the money for, and the part that they had to build, physically. The Prophet that day was there as well. He physically was there as well, alayhi salatu wasalam. And when everybody was doing their part in bringing the rocks, the Prophet did the same. And he was taking, alayhi salatu wasalam, the rocks from the place, and he was placing on the Kaaba and he was building it, alayhi salatu wasalam. And his age at that time was 35 years of age, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's the most authentic opinion in this regard, that the Prophet was 35 years of age at that time, as Abdul Razzaq ibn Hammam al-San'ani mentioned in his Musannaf, bi isnadin sahih, a chain of narration which is authentic. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated a fascinating story, which is Jabir ibn Abdullah, he said that the Prophet والسلام, told them that he was taking the what? He was taking the stones and the bricks, he was carrying them, والسلام. And the Prophet when he was carrying them on his neck. He was carrying them on his neck. And the Prophet was wearing izar, a lower garment. The izar is the lower, the bottom part. It's what we call the ma'awis in Somali. The Asians, they call it lungi. Yeah, that's the izar. The Prophet was wearing the والسلام. Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the Prophet's uncle, he saw the Prophet that day working, and he said to him, Ibn Akhi, the son of my brother. He said to him, the son of my brother. لو حللت إزارك, if only you take off your izar, what's going to happen? Yeah, عورة is going to show. If only you took your izar off and you placed it on your neck, because the brick you're putting on is going on your neck, it's going to hurt your neck like that. Don't worry about this. Just take it from the bottom and place it on your neck. فجعلت على منكبيك, and you placed it on your neck, دون الحجارة, to protect you from the rock. When it goes on your neck, you've got the izar that's protecting you from your neck. فحله, the Prophet started to open his izar, wanted to do it. فجعله على منكبيك, and he placed it, عليه الصلاة والسلام, on his neck. فسقط مخشيا على, the Prophet fainted straight away. He became unconscious, عليه الصلاة والسلام. فما رؤيا, the Prophet was never seen بعد ذلك عريان. Never was he seen after that day naked. Never. Ever since that day, the Prophet never, عليه الصلاة والسلام, none of his aura was ever seen. صلوات الله وسلم. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated this. When the building of the Kaaba, it got done, and they were doing it, and they were putting the effort in, they started to get to the point which is called the black stone. They reached the black stone. Now the black stone, Quraysh knew that it had virtue over the rest of the Kaaba. Now the black stone is very small. The black stone is what? It's very small. Okay? And it's mentioned when the Qaramita, they took the black stone. The Qaramita were one of the people who took the black stone, they took it to Yemen. They kept it there. And the Kaaba, the people, the ulama would tell the people, there's a black stone there, it's on this side, just do what the Prophet used to do. There's no black stone there. So they had it for years, and then one of the, Allah Ta'ala, the punishment and the torment and the destruction, and what they call today natural disaster, got so much in Yemen through the Qaramita, that one of the leaders said, maybe the reason why Allah's punished us like this is because we're the black stone, let's take it back to the Kaaba. So he sent it back to the Kaaba. So when they brought the black stone back to the Kaaba, the people of Mecca said, how do we know what they brought back is that? How do you know it's the black stone? How about if it's not? A stone that they painted. And they what? They bought it. So they said the black stone is weak. Take it, put it inside water. When it gets put inside water, it's the only stone that doesn't sink. What does it do? It floats up, it comes to the top surface. So if it does sink, then this is not a black stone, it's another stone that they brought to us. So they brought the black stone, they put it inside the water, it went to the surface, they said it's our black stone, they put it in. That's what's said. That is what's mentioned in the books of history. So the black stone, Quraysh got to that. When they reached that, تَنَازَعُوا فِي مَنْ يَضَعُهُ, they disputed and argued who's going to put the black stone up. فَكُلُّ قَبِيلَةٍ تُرِيدُ أَنْ تَحْضَى بِهَذَا الشَّرْفِ فَكُلُّ قَبِيلَةٍ تُرِيدُ أَنْ تَحْضَى بِهَذَا الشَّرْفِ. Each tribe, what do they want? Each tribe wants to get the honor and the respect of placing the black stone. They want to say that their tribe was the one who put it there. حَتَّى كَادَتِ الْحَرْبُ أَنْ تَشْتَعِلَ بَيْنَهُمْ فِي أَرْضِ الْحَرَمِ, until they started to take out the sticks and their swords and the weapons that they were using to build the Kaaba, they started to want to kill each other in the Kaaba. It was that close. Bloodshed was going to take place. When bloodshed reached that point, 4 and 5 nights. Some of the narration mentioned 6 nights went by, nothing was moving forward. Every tribe, argument, something was happening. Until finally, the eldest person in Quraysh at that time, who was the oldest in age, was none other than Abu Umayyah ibn al-Mughirah al-Makhzumi. He was the oldest. He's the father of who? Our mother, Umm Salama. Umm Salama's father. He was what? Umm Salama's father. Umm Salama's father is the one who was the oldest that day. وَكَانَ عَامَئِذٍ. That particular year, he was أَسَنَّ رَجُلٍ فِي قُرَيْشٍ. The oldest man in Quraysh, in age. He said to them, فَقَالَ يَا مَعْشَرَ قُرَيْشٍ. He said, O Quraysh, O Quraysh, اجعلوا بينكم. Place between you guys. فِيمَ اخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ. That which you disputed. أَوَّلُ مَنْ يَدْخُلُ مِنْ بَابِ بَنِي شَيْبَةَ. The first person who enters from the door of Bani Shayba. And today, if you want to know exactly where that Bab is, Bab of Bani Shayba, is the door of Bab al-Salam. You go to the Kaaba, it's called Bab al-Salam, that's the door. He said, the first person who enters from what? Min Babi Bani Shayba. Anybody who enters, the first person who enters from that door of Bab Bani Shayba, فَرَضُوا وَقَبِلُوا هَذَا الرَّأِي جَمَعًا. Place your matters to him, give it to him, and whatever decision he gives you, listen to him. So they also said, okay, that's a fair, because they know who, anybody's tribe can walk in, anyone's, it's not a particular person, this will sit down, whether it be this tribe or that tribe, it doesn't matter. Anyone who walks in will be a hakam and a judge between us. فَأَشْمَصُوا أَبْصَارَهُمْ مِنَ بَابِ الْمَسْجِدِ. Everybody staring at that door, who's going to come out from it, who's going to walk in, who is it going to be? Everyone's observing. This is what's going to change history for them, basically. وَشَرَأَبَّتِ الْعَنَاقِ. Those who were short, who couldn't see, they made their necks high up to see, to make sure that they're the first person to see who is it going to be, and who's going to come out from that door. فَإِذَا بِهِ. That person who came out, that walked out of that door, it turned out to be, we'll finish it for some next inshallah ta'ala week, and what happened? I will conclude there inshallah. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.